So, welcome everybody to my talk, Socializing with FMT, Becoming Familiar with the FMT Library. First of all, let me introduce myself. My name is Daniela Engert. I am an electrical engineer, and for 40 years now I'm constructing computers and develop software, mostly in the realm of digital signal processing, 20 years on electromagnetic waves, radio communications, and the last 10 years, ultrasound waves in steel. I work at a small company in the south of Germany. We are really small, just 9 people in the engineering, and we are creating custom machines for non-destructive testing. And so here you see some of our products. This is the smallest one, even larger one. This is rollers in bearings. Here's in a steel factory with a robotic feet. Here we are testing wheel axles of railways. If you happen to have come by train to Berlin, the wheel axles of these trains are almost certainly be tested by this machine developed 10 years ago by me. And our largest one in a steel mill, large plates, 20 meters long, 4 meters wide, probably this thick, and tested using ultrasound. This portal would move over the plate, and we are looking for flaws in these steel plates. So, how did I come to this formatting library called FMT? Well, as we already all know, we have the printf family of functions from the C library. It's not actually safe in any kind of regard. It's not extendable, but it has a really good feature, a compact format string, which makes it easy to understand what's going on there. And later compilers can deal with the syntax of these format strings quite well. Usually it's highly optimized, so everything is good in this regard. Then our most hated options, probably the IO streams. It has a really verbose and awkward syntax. This format string is totally cluttered, and the specifications are intermingled into the string itself, so it's really difficult to see what would the result of the formatting be. Because of its OOP design, it's not actually that fast as we like it to be, but in the end, it's extendable and it's type safe, which is a big bonus. Then option three, we have a multitude of third-party libraries which would do formatting for us, but one of the most common ones probably is Boost Format, and it has some really nice features. It's type safe, it has a compact format string, it's extendable, has a multitude of formatting options which is not available from the other options so far. It can reuse its arguments, but power comes at a price. It's slow to compile and slow to run. And of course, we have our large C++ frameworks. Probably the most common one is Qt. It comes also with an option how to format strings. And it's type safe, it has a compact format string. Syntax is not as good. And the worst thing of it is usually any kind of third-party of C++ framework comes with its own type of string. So if you want to go and get some stud string out of it, you have to convert. Well, it's not the kind of situation we want to be in. So I had a really pressing need for some better option. In our company, we have to deal with lots of external hardware, which is not standard computer hardware. On the upper half of the picture, you see an ultrasound device. After reverse engineering its protocol, I found out it's totally text-based, and it's very easy to get slow performance out of it if your communication and text processing is too slow. On the lower half of the picture, you see an ultrasound device developed by me. You have an FPGA, which would spit out about 400 megabytes per second of data. Even if you want to debug the data stream which is coming out of this device on the other side of the communications channel, it's virtually impossible just to use the standard formatting libraries at hand to see what's going on there if there is any kind of problem with the protocol. So I needed something which is really fast and wouldn't block behind the scenes, probably because of an mutex or an allocation or whatever it might be, which would just slow down our communications. So every time I've been looking for a formatting library which would fix all my problems, well, this is the result that I got from Google. Or anywhere else. Well, finally, I encountered the format library. It was quite a surprise such kind of thing existed, even though I thought C++11 would really make such kind of thing possible. And the history of this library is such that in 2012, Viktor Zverovich, the original designer, had probably the same needs as I. So he designed a library which is much better suited to the task. Actually, at the time I encountered it, it was still named CPP Format, quite a dull name. But later on, because of its signature feature of the formatting syntax, it was renamed to FMT with the pair of braces. In its later versions, it requires just a modest feature set from C++11. Maybe every compiler in the last 5 years can deal with it. It's liberally licensed. Anybody can use it, even in a commercial context. And it's in active development. So this is what I want to present in the next minutes. FMT, the basic stuff, and let's peek a little bit under the hood. Let's try to format all the things and all the strings, and a little bit about date and time formatting, and let's peek into the future. So, how does the formatting syntax look like, and what kind of functions do we have to use it? Well, the most basic function available and typically used is obviously format. It takes a templated format string and a bunch of templated arguments. Internally, it has a buffer to collect all the characters created throughout the formatting. This buffer is typically not allocated on the heap, but in some inline space of the buffer itself, which would be allocated just on the stack or in global memory, depending on where you call it. It returns a basic string, and the usage is quite obvious. Actually, depending on the code unitype of the formatting string, the whole operation internally is determined. It determines the kind of code unit it would be used at the output result. In which case, in this example, we had a string literal of const jar of 17 elements because of the jar. All the formatting is done in terms of jars. Actually, you can use any kind of character type. The older ones, jar and WCHAR-T, and the newer ones, the Unicode ones, jar-AT, jar-16T, and jar-32T. You can even have your own jar types as long as your jar traits have a matching specialization for it. So there's probably no limit on what kind of code unit types you can operate on. Then, if you need localized numeric formatting, you can do that too, but despite of what's probably known from the printf library, you get local aware formatting only if you really wanted to. In many cases, you don't need it, so you don't have to pay for it. So, as I said, the formatting is done in terms of a common code unit type. So all your strings that you're giving it as arguments also have to match this common code unit type. There is no explicit conversion to be done here. If you mix and match code unit types, you get a compiler error out of it. In some cases, you don't want to have an internal buffer. Maybe it's not large enough according to your formatting needs or other reasons. You can just use an external buffer, and you would feed an output iterator into this buffer so that you can have any kind of buffer that you want. So it's up to you how to use it in here. Here's an example. I use a std vector of WCHAR-Ts in this example as a format buffer, and the result is the obvious thing. You get a vector of size 2 with the characters 4 and 2 if you just default formatting the number 42. In some cases, you can get away with just a single allocation beforehand if you're lucky enough to resize your buffer beforehand, and in some cases you might even want to keep this buffer around so you don't have to allocate any further. So if you have additional the restriction that you have a fixed size buffer, maybe in a protocol you can only have 8, 10, or whatever kind of characters in your formatted output, you can put an upper limit to it, and you get a truncated result up to this given limit, and in the output from this function, you get also the information how large should have been your buffer if you didn't want to get any kind of truncation. In this case, I use a U16 string from Visual Studio with small string optimization. The default allocated capacity is just 7 jars in this case, and if I limit my formatting operation to just this buffer size, the already allocated capacity, well, in this case, with the small number 42, I don't get even one allocation, and if I have a much larger number, I don't have an allocation because of the size limit, but it would tell me 11 would have been probably better to have a capacity. Actually, this internal buffer, which is called basic memory buffer, can be used also as an external buffer, and you have the additional option to predetermine what capacity this inline buffer should be. Typically, it's default 500 characters, but if you need larger buffers or can't get away with much smaller buffers, you can template on the actually buffer size, which should be the inline capacity. In this case, I'm using a memory buffer of jar with 100 characters inline space, and use this as my formatting buffer in this case. Actually, you can have as many of these buffers as you like, and you can put multiple formatting into the same buffer, so you can build up your formatting strings piecewise, and maybe you just do a concatenation by the final formatting operation. And all of this can be done without any kind of allocation if you don't want to do them. Well, some more fancy stuff. You can have user-defined literals to turn a literal string into a formatting string. Actually, this is just the same kind of thing we had in the first call, the function format. It's just a little bit around. And much more useful is the capability of using user-defined literals to give arguments a name. So using such a name, you can have much more easily to understand formatting strings, where you can not just say, okay, put an argument here, but put an argument using this semantic in here. In this case, I gave the 42, the obvious ID, the answer, and in the formatting string, I have the replacement slot where I would say, okay, put the answer in here. So it's not only easier for you as a developer to use named arguments, because you don't have the problem forgetting about which argument would go into which replacement field, but also if you have external translators who don't really understand what's going on here, you put speaking names into your formatting strings and your translators will probably give you much better translations because they understand what's really going on here. You can also have compile time format strings. So as you know it from the printer family, where the compiler would understand your syntax, you can also do it the same here. You have a compile time string and the formatting library just checks for the syntax of this format string and the matching types of the arguments so that you don't have any bad surprises at runtime. Of course, this only works if you have const expert qualified formatters throughout your arguments. And yeah, probably another problem is not every compiler is capable of using compile time strings. So there is a kind of an emulation here which would work on every compiler which has at least working C++ 14 relaxed const expert support. There is another problem with compile time strings. If you need runtime translation, this just matches the fixed compile time strings. So you have to be a little bit more inventive how to make both the compile time string checking work and the runtime translation kind of stuff. So you probably have to have a pre-compile step which would just check the syntax and the matching arguments, and then another full compile where you don't have a compile time string but a dynamic string to be translated during runtime. Of course, you don't always want to just format into a memory buffer. You can also output to the console and to a file stream. In this case, it's just a different function, no longer format, but print. If you don't like the syntax of the formatting library, you can still use your own old familiar printf function family names and the same syntax, even though you even get a better syntax and an expanded syntax over the standard C library syntax. In this case, you have even positional arguments from the POSIX formatting syntax here. All these functions are basically equivalent. The standard functions use the standard syntax, and the printf-like functions use the C printf syntax, but under the hood, it's just the same. Speaking of the formatting syntax, as you would expect, it's an alternating sequence of literal text fields and replacement fields, and replacement fields are just surrounded by a pair of curly braces. So here you see examples of valid formatting strings and invalid formatting strings. As usual, we have to escape the curly braces if we need literal curly braces in our output. A replacement field is divided into two parts. The leading part is an argument ID to denote which argument should go into this replacement field. And you have, of course, a formatting specification. Actually, you can get away without any kind of formatting specification and argument ID. In this case, it's everything just a default. Here are examples of the formatting syntax. The first one is just the default formatting of the next argument, which is not taken up so far. The second one is just the same, with the optional colon separating the fields. And the third example is a numerical index of which argument should go into this replacement field. The fourth one is a named argument. These argument identifiers are actually quite an interesting feature. You can use a numerical indexing into the arguments, and you can have the named arguments, and so you can use any times an argument as you like. This is totally different to what you probably are used to from the printf formatting and from other formatting libraries. Argument identifiers are just as you would expect from regular C++. You start with index 0 for the first argument, and you can use actually any kind of name in named arguments. The only thing that you can't do, you can't use Unicode characters, so no fancy smileys and such kind of things. Here we see examples of how this can be done. In the first example, we have a named argument called A. And as you can see, even if the argument is named, you don't have to use the name. Just default indexing works just as well. In the second example, we have the same argument, but a formatting string which takes a replacement field by a numerical indexing, the first argument in this case, and the second replacement field is using the names of the argument. In both cases, it would be replaced by 42. The third example is invalid because you can't mix automatic indexing with explicit indexing, but this probably is no problem if you're used to this kind of stuff. The formatting specification is exactly the same as you would expect from the printer family. You have a few more possibilities when it comes to alignment, but everything else is just the same. What you don't have to put into your replacement fields or formatting specifications is the actual type that you're giving to your arguments. It's by default everything deduced, only if you have to need special formatting because you have special needs regarding floating points or integral types, you can put it in there, but everything here is optional regarding the types. One of the interesting features of the formatting library is you can change about anything. We have seen an example. We have the standard formatting syntax from the library, and we have the support by a different set of formatting functions using the old printf formatting syntax. If you don't like either of these, just come up with your own syntax and you can use it with the rest of the library just the same. Are there any questions so far? Okay. Let's. The question is, what is the default buffer size internally? It's 500 characters, probably a good choice for many formatting needs. If you need a larger buffer or a smaller buffer, you can use an explicit argument as I showed. So, how is the internal structure of the library so that you can understand what's going on in the later parts of the talk? We have a type-aware outer interface where everything is templated. In this example, I would use the format function, which has a templated format string and a variadic pack of templated arguments. And many people are not really sure if all these templates are really a good thing, because of probably template explosions and code bloats. There's an inner interface which does use a kind of type erasure so that the actual inner part of the library has just a few different types that it has to deal with. Every string in the string in the formatting string is reduced to an internal basic string view, which is not the same basic string view as you would get from the standard library, but it's an implementation within the formatting library, which is just, yeah, it works on every compiler and every compilation mode, and you don't have these hundreds of member functions you would expect or would get from the standard library. Is just the reference to the beginning of a char sequence and its length. That's all about it, and some conversion constructors from the standard string types, just C strings, basic string, and basic string view. All the formatting arguments are reduced to a single internal container, which holds on to these arguments and reduces the built-in types and your own user types into kind of a variant. So what the internal machinery has to deal with just a single container of a known set of types. After all this type erasure, every formatting operation enters the formatting engine through a single function, which is called vformat, which takes just these two internal argument types. And the formatting engine uses a large set of built-in formatters for any of the built-in types and all the string types, and it can, in addition, use user-defined formatters for every user-defined type by you, so you're not limited to the set of built-in formatting functions, but you can expand it as much as you like. All of these layers are held together by a context, which is just a templated struct which holds on to the formatting string. It supplies a random access range of the rest of the formatting string not consumed so far. It has a output iterator type where all the formatted characters would go, basically the sink of the formatting operations. It has a error handler. This error handler can also be modified if you don't like the default error handling of the machine. And it has a code point type, which is used throughout the formatting process. If you need additional information, you can put it into your own specializations of these format of this context template, so you have every kind of customizability to modulate the operations within the formatting core. I've already explained the type erasure, what's going there, the relationship between the functions at the outer interface layer and the inter interface layer, and what's going on with strings at the outer interface and the inner interface, and how the user types and the argument, the formatting arguments are stored in a type erase container in the internal. So, with all this basic information, we will enter how to extend the library to your types. Are there any questions so far? Yes?
So it's regarding the first part of the talk. You're saying you can use a fixed size buffer.
Yeah.
And let's say you want to format a string which is bigger than the buffer. The end result, so you have a format string which is bigger than the buffer. And you said that in this case, it's going to populate only until the size of the buffer. My question is this string at the end going to include a null terminator, or it's just going to have something? So the last element of the buffer is going to be null terminator or not?
If I have understood you correctly, the question is what's going on if the size of the internal buffer is smaller than the format string?
Exactly.
Well, actually, the format string has, at this point, no relationship to the internal buffer. So, if you have if the literal fields are probably overflowing the internal capacity,
yes,
you would have to resort to a heap allocation. This is true. So, if you know in advance that your formatting string is so large.
I mean, I really want a fixed size buffer. So I want only a buffer of 10 elements.
Yeah.
Right? So I don't want to, and you said you have a function where you can say just fill in 10 elements. It was at some point such a function, right? You don't want to go over that buffer.
Well, actually, there is no such kind of buffer available and no function who would work like you are pointing it out. But using the functions from the inner interface layer, you can easily implement such kind of functionality yourself.
Okay, so it means I misunderstood. I understood that if you provide the fixed size buffer, it's going to populate only that buffer and is not going to allocate if it needs more.
Well, it would allocate if
it would allocate. Okay, so yeah. I misunderstood before.
But if you want to avoid this allocation, you have to supply it from the external outside. Or you may even implement a function which would have a much larger internally allocated buffer.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much.
So, in the part of extending the library, I use another include that's provided by the formatting library, which is called color.h. Using this additional overloads of print, you can actually create colorful output on the terminal if you like to. Using this, you have to give the RGB components in a struct called RGB, and you can define then the foreground color and possibly also the background color. Here you see an example. I'm using a background color which should be printed as its color components in a hexadecimal formatted way. And this is the typical way to deal with aggregates, in this case this struct. You decompose it into its components and feed it into individual replacement fields, but it's probably not what we want to do with formatting our own types. So this is tedious, it's error prone, and the formatting library can do much better. Actually, every formatter in the library, well, almost all formatters in library are just specializations of this basic primary formatter template. You have to define which type a formatter should be responsible for. You can say it's responsible maybe for all character, all chord points or chord units, or you can say any chord unit would be okay. And you have a sphenoid slot to restrict the set of formatters to any kind of predicates you like to. The formatter struct has two basic functions. One is called the parse function. It just interprets a replacement field and the formatting specification in there. And a second one, it's called format, which does the actual formatting of a given value. Here we see two examples of it. The first one is just a simple formatter for just one code unit type. In this case, it's in WHRT. And the second one takes advantage of the sphenoid slot. Here we say we accept for this formatter any character type which has a size of 2 bytes, and it should be responsible for every type which is a derived type from a given base type. So it's quite flexible in here. You can do whatever you need. As I said, the parse function is responsible for parsing the formatting specifier part of a replacement field, and it's a random access range, so you have to start from the next unconsumed character up to the closing curly brace. The format function then uses the parsed information and would sync the generated characters during the formatting process into the iterator supplied by the out method from the context. So if you have special needs regarding where to the characters should go, you have to provide if you don't like the defaults, your own context type, which would replace the out type of the output iterator. Actually, many of the formatting functions that I have showed in the first part just use this kind of method to modulate the formatting process. In the first part, we had the format 2, and the format 2n, and all of these have been just different kinds of output iterators, which just control how the actual code character generation should go. Start with a simple formatter for our struct RGB. Just as we've seen before, we should get our three components out of it side by side using a formatting specification which is just the same for every component. And lazy as we are, we should reuse as much as we can from the already supplied formatters. How do we do that? Here you see my formatter for the RGB type just derives from a built-in formatter for the type of the actual individual color component. And because I'm not too fancy regarding the parsing, I can even get away with all the parsing. The formatting operation is absolutely straightforward. Just call the format method from the derived from formatter three times, once for each color component. This is really trivial, so nothing fancy here. The result is exactly the same as before. Notice I have just one replacement field here, so I don't have to decompose or destructure my user-defined type. Maybe we want to get a little bit more fancy. We want a delimiter between each of the individual color components, and we want to have a pair of braces around it, or parentheses. Then it's basically the same as before, just we have to get access to the output iterator. You can get it from the context, or we can get it from the formatting operation of the base formatter type. The result is just as expected. Our comma delimited individual components surrounded by parentheses. I will skip this part. If you have very special needs regarding parsing your formatting specification, you have to fit the extended language into the existing formatting language. Here I have defined some additional parts which should be parsed out of the formatting specification, but as we all know, formatting and parsing is quite a tedious part, so we don't probably go into detail here. If you want to study it in detail, you can download all these slides already from the Meeting C++ website and study it in detail or ask me later. The formatting is basically the same as before, only we have no longer hard-coded characters and this is the information which is just parsed out of the extended specification language. Here you see an example of this extended formatting specification language and the result, and the same here with an user-defined delimiter between the color components. In many cases, you probably have overloaded output stream operators for your character types and you prefer to reuse them. You can do it as well. Just include a header called ostream.h and the formatting library then would create a custom formatter out of this overloaded output streaming operator on your behalf. It just does it by creating a temporary output stream and call your overloaded output streaming operator on it. Just be aware, if the library creates a custom formatter out of these operators, you can't, in addition to do your own custom formatters, because you can have only one. Otherwise, your compiler would say this is not possible. So far we had only strings from the standard library, but the world is much wider. You have many more character types which you could use. You can even use other containers with characters in them and treat them like strings. So we need a way to use any kind of string or string-like types to be used as either a formatting string or as an argument. And this should just work out of the box. As I've already told, everything is basically converted into a basic string view. So we need a means to get from all these different kinds of strings to this basic string view. Obviously, you can't do it by converting operators or user-defined operators, conversion operators. So we need some kind of thing which is a named conversion operator, which can be found by ADL for any kind of string type. And this is how it's done. We have a free function called toString_view, or it may be even a templated toString_view function, which takes your string type and returns a format basic string view out of it. Of course, a string view is not a value type, but rather a reference type, so your references to the character stream of the given input string type must be valid for the whole operation of the formatting process. Actually, a string is no longer defined by this is a string, but rather we have a conversion from any given kind of type to a FMT basic string view. So if there happened to be such a conversion, it's treated like a string. So here in this case, I have an MFC string. It has gotten this toString_view conversion operator, and putting this just into your program, it would work without any explicit conversion. Same with qstrings. So using these named conversion operators, you can match any kind of string that you have without any conversion to a stud string beforehand. And the best thing is, there is no allocation here. So, it's not only arguments and strings, but we have to deal with localization as well, which means text translation, local aware number rendering, and date and type formatting. Well, the localized number rendering is done by using the numpunct facet from the locale. Message translation or text translation has to be done externally by some kind of translation machinery. Probably the most well-known one is GNU/GetText. There is also the boost locale implementation of just the same kind of thing. And if you're going with Qt, you have the Qt translation system, but there are many more options when it comes to translation. GNU/GetText is easy to handle because it's just C strings. The same is with Qt strings. We have already learned how to use this conversion operator, and this is probably true for most string types. Boost locale is a different kind of beast. The translate function just returns a proxy kind of object which just collects the input arguments, and the actual translation process is done using a explicit or implicit conversion to a std string. you might think, okay, std::string is not a difficult thing to handle, but in this case, if we have a fictitious std::string conversion operator and get the translated std::string out of the message itself and turn it into a string view, well, we get a dangling reference to the returned ephemeral string, so this is not exactly the kind of thing we want to have. You can get away with a customized user-defined formatter for it. In this case, the returned string is living long enough to be used during the formatting process. So, using these kind of techniques, we can translate our formatting string and our string arguments just like we want to, mix and match even the translation systems. If you happen to have a augmented version of Boost Local, you can even get really cheap translations from the GetText system. Numeric formatting, as I said, it's you have to ask for local aware numeric formatting. And, well, so far, float and doublecon formatting is done by the standard library functions, but this will change in the future using a really fast formatter. Probably it's GRISU. Currently it's GRISU implemented, but there is even faster ones. We will see how it turns out. And even more interesting is possibly date and time formatting. The library itself comes with a support for time and date formatting using the C time T type, but there is currently no support for the C++ chrono date and time types. Well, actually, the date types from chrono will arrive in C++ 20. If you have need to do it today, you can use the reference implementation of these new types from Howard Hinnant. And so we have to implement the formatting for durations and all these different time point derived types ourselves. Actually, there is a formatting facility in the C++ 20 standard which gives you the opportunity to format these chronotypes, but you have to set up the scene such that it would work. So I'm using here a common base class, base formatter, which does the parsing and base formatting kind of thing, and all this is required because the actual formatting is done by a function called toStream, which requires an output stream from the IOStreams library, and it requires a zero-terminated formatting string, and this is really kind of sad because we don't have zero-terminated character strings here. So this unnecessary copying of the formatting syntax is just required because of that. So maybe our C++ standards committee will rethink this kind of date and time formatting and give us a better option to deal with it. Then we just have to derive from our basic time point formatting. In this case, I have a chrono time point and I have a zone time from the C++ 20 library. And in addition to that, a special formatter for the chrono durations. And this is how you would use it. So, let's have a quick peek into the future, what's going on there. Actually, in the last couple of weeks, we had a really wide expansion of the scope of the library. We can deal with any kind of character type now. We can deal with any kind of string type now. But there are still some minor things which you probably would want to have, even in particular when it comes to localized formatting. Well, let's see how much time I find for that. Then there's the standardization process. Victor had a proposal about 1.5 years ago. It underwent several rounds of review in the standardization committee. And last week at the San Diego meeting, it was finally approved from its design. So it's forwarded to the library working group for the proper wording. And if all planets align, we will have it in the C++ 20 standard. So, as I said, the proposal is 1.5 years ago, so if you really want all the features that I have presented here, you're probably better off using the real library from the current GitHub page and not wait for the C++ 20 library implementation. Maybe we even get the additional features, but I wouldn't count on it. So if you need more information about this library, go to fmtlib.net. The GitHub page is fmtlib.fmt. Victor gave an interesting talk on CppCon 2017. I really recommend to watch it and get some more information about the background of the library and how he went to implement it this way. You can read the latest standards proposal and contact me on my email address and my GitHub page. All these interesting illustrations have been done by Maria Sibylla Merian, which happened to live in the 17th century in my hometown before she went to Suriname and explored the nature of South America. So, this is what I wanted to present. Any more questions about this library?
There we go. Okay. How much of libc++ or other thing, libseed or other things does this drag in? If I just want to format ints, am I going to drag in the world, or am I just going to get a very lean int formatting library?
Actually, you can get away with just three headers, and if you're just formatting ints, it wouldn't require anything from the standard library.
Yay!
And if you need to format floating point types and you switch on the Grisu formatter, you don't even have to rely on the standard library for that.
More yay!
Thanks for the talk. It was really interesting to know about this. The question I have is, what happens if I just write some bogus formatting string? For example, it has this default braces thing and then mixed in with the number and the name, or I just referring to a number which is not existing because I'm not giving that. Is that something, hopefully, that boils out during compilation, not during runtime? And if during compilation, is it some weird template error message I have to look through, or is it maybe a little bit better composed with some assertion that I can figure out the error real quick?
Actually, if you don't use compile time strings as formatting strings, you would get an exception
error
at runtime.
Oh, okay.
You can customize that as well, But if you resort to compile time strings, you get a compilation error. And as I showed on the things to be done, error messages can be improved.
Okay, thank you for that.
Hi. Can you use format, printf, and IOStream all together? Are they synchronized with each other, or are you kind of all one and have to commit?
Well, actually, if you want to output the formatting result from format into an output stream, is this the question that you have? Okay,
so it just formats. There's no output. There's no IO, basically.
I don't...
Basically, printf and IOStream, for example, are synchronized with each other, right? So if you... No?
I don't see any
interaction. The first question, which was an assumption which maybe is wrong, is that format can also print out like printf can, but maybe that's not true.
This is true.
Okay. So can you call an IOStream function and a printf function without flushing the buffer in between
interleaved? There is no synchronization between these two outputting methods so far.
Okay, so you
format is meant as a replacement for all this kind of stuff.
Okay, got it.
Regarding the error messages, a month ago I made a pull request to improve the error message when you try to format a type that doesn't have a formatter.
Yeah.
So now you'll get a single static asset. I don't know how to format that type. Include the OStream header if you want to use the OStream-based overload.
That's true. But there are many more cases in which we could improve the error messages.
I didn't run into that error message, so yeah. I didn't fix that. So, yeah.
So, unfortunately, the session is over. You can ask me anything during this evening. And
one more question.
Okay, one more question.
thanks for this very good presentation. I like these pictures very much. my question, can you give some numbers about the runtime overhead of this when using this formatter?
Yeah, I could if I would copy the stuff from the presentation Victor gave last year. It's probably better to watch his presentation, where he had many benchmarks on the formatting kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So it's probably no use that I repeat it just again. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thanks.
Okay.